Today. Welcome. If you're visiting with us, we're so glad you're here. Welcome to this family of God and this wonderful sanctuary that we have here. And I am one of those, I love the Old Testament. I am drawn to Nehemiah and Isaiah and Ezekiel, and I love them. And this morning when I opened up my Bible, I opened up to the last chapter of Ezekiel, and I thought, oh, that's a lot of numbers. You know, God's dividing out the land, and I thought, oh, okay, that's a lot of numbers. And immediately my eyes were drawn to the last line, and I just smile because I love when God has something for me. And the name of the city from that time on will be, The Lord Is There. How amazing to think that within our city here, God abides here and dwells with us. And then when I read the commentary, the book of Ezekiel begins by describing the holiness of God that Israel had despised and ignored. As a result, God's presence departed from the temple, the city, and the people. But the book ends, and I've seen the back of the book, and I know how the story ends. But the book of Ezekiel ends with a detailed vision of the new temple, the new city, and the new people, all demonstrating God's holiness. The pressures of everyday life may persuade us to focus on the here and now and thus forget God, but that is why we worship. And that is why worship is so important. It takes our eyes off our current worries, gives us a glimpse of God's holiness, and allows us to look forward to His future kingdom. God's presence makes everything glorious, and worship brings us into His presence. And that's what we're going to do this morning as we sing, we lift our voices, we lift our hands and our hearts to the glorious city of God and our Father that sits on the throne this morning. All hail King Jesus.
I'll see.
empty until the Master steps in and makes us whole. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Melt me, mold me, use me. And he will. If we step out on that faith, let him take control of our lives. He will use us.
Was battered and scarred, and the auctioneer thought really it wasn't worth much time to spend. As he held the old violin up with a bow, he said, "Who'll give me five? Who'll give me 10? The bidding ceased early, and silence filled the room till an elderly gentleman came from the back to the front and picked up the old violin with the bow and began to play a melody as sweet as any angel could ever sing. Tears begin to flow, silence fill the room. He placed the violin back down, went back to his seat. The auctioneer, through tears, held the violin and the bow up and said, "Who'll give me 1,000? Who'll give me 2? And the bidding just kept increasing. What changed the worth of that old violin, you might ask? It was the touch of the master's hand. You didn't know it, had no way of knowing it. But I prayed for you at 3:00 this morning. And I said, Lord, if it would please you and be according to your will, would you touch people in the Sunday morning service today? See if the Holy Spirit doesn't touch you. You've came in vain." So I asked the Lord to send the Holy Spirit up and down these aisles this morning. I pray he touches you. As we go to prayer, thanking him and praising him, remember the sick. There's so many that are written there in the bulletin. So many called in to the prayer chain. If I was 21, I couldn't remember all of them. More or less 65. But let's remember to pray for those that are sick. I miss the prayer singers. And Sister Nettie is getting ready to make the crossover. And Nettie Baker, let's remember her and her family as we pray. Some of you are facing surgeries. Some of you are recovering from illnesses and surgeries. Always miss Sid and Phyllis when they're not able to come. And just so many, and so many of you are caring for your loved ones. And we want to remember you in prayer. I'm glad this world's not our final home. But until then, let's keep carrying on with God's grace. Our country's in a mess. It grieves me to even listen. In fact, I have almost quit. But continue to pray for our nation. Pray for the Lord's church. As I was praying at 3 o'clock this morning, I said, Lord, I thank you for my church. It's your church. But I thank you for the day that you made me a part of it. I love the church. Pray that you do too. I've taught my boys to cherish the church. One thing I can guarantee you this morning, you got a little angel back there that loves the church. Thank you, angel, for these decorations in the fall. But as we go to prayer this morning, if God's answered a prayer for you or you need a prayer answered, I can sense his presence, can't you? As the choir sings, feel free to come. He's answered a prayer for you, and you need a prayer answered. This is the place to come. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Jesus, for the privilege to be able to come and to call upon you with praise, with thanksgiving. We worship you this morning in spirit and in truth. And Lord, this morning, as we worship you, we bring our prayers and our petitions to a God that hears and answers prayer. So, Lord, we pray, you know what we have need of even before we ask. You said if we'd ask, we'd receive. If we'd seek, we'd find. If we'd knock upon the door through the prayer of faith, you'd open it. So, Lord, meet and supply those needs that are being asked of you this morning. Walk these aisles. Speak to every heart. And as we're praying this morning, we have a lady here that wants to be anointed. If you'll come to the communion table. And Brother Mark, would you grab that oil right there and pray in a, we're going to pray an anointing prayer for this one that wants to be anointed. We believe in divine healing. Heavenly Father, as we anoint with oil, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, as our ladies gather around and touch her, we pray for a supernatural touch that comes only from you. Oh, when you touch us, we know it. We know that somebody's touched us. And so, Lord, this morning, whatever that need may be, whatever that anointing's for, do the work that only you can do, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Thank you. You may be seated. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Pastor Mike. Thank you. Please don't forget choir practice tonight at 5, evening service at 6. 4:45, Sunday School Board meeting. Sunday School Board meeting at 5. Then our church board meeting Tuesday night at 7 o'clock. And I need 15 minutes a day out of you for prayer for revival. Praying for revival, it starts Sunday. We'll be Sunday through Wednesday. Plan on being here every night. We've got some of the best workers in the denomination. And so I believe that certainly you need to make yourself available and be praying about the revival and praying about your revival pledge. When you call the best, they're a little more expensive than the rest. But believe me when I tell you they're worth every penny that this church will give them because of their loyalty and love for the Lord. Ushers, come at this time and we'll receive our Sunday morning tithes and offerings. Steve, you want to bless them?
I desire your prayers this morning. Christy and I were talking first thing. She said, I got to sing tonight and I can't. I said, honey, transpose those congregationals down a notch for me because I am too. But it's not about what we sound like. It's about the message that God has today. And I knew immediately that this song was what the Lord wanted for this morning. We all face challenges. We face sorrow. We face pain. There's a lot that people are facing today, and it seems like more so as the time draws near to the end. But always know that then when the moment that there's you think that there's no hope, there is always grace.
Just won't come. You hate to see the sunrise on another day. and you dread the sorrow that waits for tomorrow. You're out of hope, but thank God for grace. When there's no hope, let the blood take your place, and there's no trial He can't erase. When there's no hope, thank God for grace. When there's no hope, thank God for grace. When the hours in your days seem like eternity, oh, no matter what you do, the pain just won't leave. You start to think that life is over, your burden's hard to bear. Remember at your lowest, let the blood take your place, and there's no trial He can't erase. When there's no hope, thank God for grace. When there's no hope, thank God for grace. So no matter, the blood will prevail. Just past all the sorrow, remember He's still there. And there's no trial He can't erase. When there's no hope, thank God for grace. When there's no hope, thank God for grace.
Have your Bibles, be turning to the book of Ephesians, the 30th verse. They'll put it on the screen. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30. Paul is telling and teaching and referring to one of the greatest sins of the last days. He's telling us to beware of it. He's telling us not to do it. But it is prevalent and predominant in our world today. There in verse 30, he says, "And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption." Don't continually resist the efforts of the Holy Spirit in your life. Don't continually rebel and tell the third person of the Godhead no. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. Don't continually refuse Him. Refuse not the Holy Spirit that speaketh. And yet, in the dispensation that we're living in this morning, it is labeled or called the Holy Ghost dispensation. God dealt with people in the Old Testament. Jesus preached and proclaimed the lostness of people in the New Testament. And then as He prepared to go back to the Father, He told His disciples, it's necessary that I go away. If I don't, the Holy Spirit will not come. But when He has come, I want to put Him in you. He'll not only be with you, but He will be in you to reprove the world of sin, righteousness, and judgment to come. It's not by might, nor by power, nor by education, nor by rituals, but it's by My Spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. The reason that I asked the Lord to speak to you this morning is because without the Spirit of Christ living within your life, you're none of His. So I want to lift three thoughts this morning about grieving the Holy Spirit. I doubt if I'm speaking to one person that has not, in one time or another, grieved the Holy Spirit. Some of you are still doing it. But as I look at this scripture, I look at, when I think of the Holy Spirit, it awes me to realize that the Holy Spirit is the third person of the Godhead. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. Paul said He's the sealer of man's redemption or salvation. That tells me we've got to have Him in order to be saved. He has to live within us, and it's the Holy Spirit that will witness to our spirit whether or not we're children of God. Now, if you're not a Christian, or you don't know whether or not you are one, I got good news for you. You're going to find out this morning. Because the Holy Spirit is alive and well. And you can control a lot of things in this life. But there's one thing you can't control. And that's the Holy Ghost speaking to you. And when I think of the Holy Ghost, the Bible calls the Holy Spirit the earnest of our inheritance. It says that because after we get saved, we realize day by day, week by week, year by year, how important the Holy Spirit is in our life. He leads, He guides, He directs. The Holy Spirit is our helper. God help the person who's trying to live this life without the help of the Holy Spirit. Jesus told the disciples, you're going to need a helper. And that helper is the Holy Ghost. You're going to need a comforter. My brother's still battling the loss of his godly wife. There'll be days that he's better than others. Just like you, if you've lost a mate or a child. And there'll be days that you're down. And the Holy Spirit knows those days. And you'll get a card through the mail or a phone call or a total stranger will grab your hand, not knowing what's going on in your life. But they'll tell you, I'm praying for you. My brother went to get some work done on his car a couple of weeks ago, and he was sharing with the receptionist that he had just lost his wife. And she said, oh, Mr. Bauer, we're so sorry. He said, Phil, I had no indication that anybody in that place was Christians. But he said, when I got ready to leave, she handed me my keys and said, we'll be praying for you. He said, well, I've not paid the bill yet. She said, you don't have no bill. Go on. No, I've not paid the... She said, you don't owe nothing. The mechanic said, go on. And he said, do you know they didn't charge me a thing? He said, that had to be of God, didn't it? I said, you better believe that. The Holy Ghost is a comforter. Do you ever go back to your home after an accident or leave the funeral home and everybody's gone but you? And you think in your mind, what am I to do? How am I going to make it? And you just don't seem to see any way. The Holy Spirit's a counselor. He sends thoughts into your heart and into your mind. You just didn't get them. It wasn't a coincidence that them came to you little by little. The Holy Spirit was silently speaking to you to get you to recognize Him. You don't have to live very long in life. where if you're observant or aware, I try to observe. I try not to miss a thing. Somebody said, boy, Pastor sure don't miss nothing, does he? Well, I try not to. But the Holy Spirit is a protector. When you're out on the highway, when people mean to do you harm, it's the Holy Spirit that shields you. It's the Holy Ghost that protects you. The psalmist writes about it, and so does the writer of Proverbs, how the great protector protected you against wrong, sin, and evil. The Holy Spirit is an intercessor. Do you know the Holy Ghost talks to God about you? He does. The Holy Spirit intercedes to the Father for your behalf. You know why He does that? Because many times you don't know how. Or many times you're too proud to do it. So the Holy Spirit does for you what you are not doing for yourself. The Holy Spirit is our guide. I'd hate to go through this life without the guidance of the Holy Spirit. I pray for wisdom every morning before I even get out of bed. Lord, you promised in the book of James that if I'd ask and I'd do it in faith, you'd give me wisdom. So Holy Spirit, impart to me that wisdom. And check me if I get out of the spirit and into the flesh. Second thing that Paul's mentioning here. Not only the Holy Ghost, but he's counseling us. He's teaching us. Whatever you do, and it's a choice. We blame it on everybody else, but it's a personal choice. Grieve not the Holy Spirit. Do you ever grieve the Holy Spirit? Sure you have. And when He lets you know that you did that, how'd you feel? How'd that work for you? When you leave a place where Almighty God is dealing with you and you won't do what He wants you to do, how do you feel about that? He said, harden not your heart. Our hearts have become so hardened anymore. We've heard so much preaching. We've heard so much singing that nothing seems to bother us anymore. But He counsels us, refuse not Him that speaketh. For if they didn't escape, those that refused Him on earth, how shall we escape if we refuse Him that speaks from heaven? Rebel not, for rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. It's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God. Multitude of people God's chosen people. People that God loved and brought the gospel to. people that God sent preachers and prophets to lead them out of slavery, out of sin, through the wilderness, into a land that he had promised them called the Promised Land. He led them out of Egypt. It was only an 11 days journey. And yet, because they grieved the Holy Spirit, that 11 days journey turned into 40 years. And the ones that were led out of Egypt died in the wilderness, except for two, Joshua and Caleb. All the rest of them perished. Now their children went into the Promised Land, but they didn't. Why did they die in the wilderness? Why did it take them 40 years to travel the 11 days journey? Because they lived grieving the Holy Spirit. The conclusion of grieving the Holy Spirit is found in the book of Proverbs, chapter 1, starting with verse 23 and reading down through verse 33. If you have your Bibles, I'd appreciate it if you'd look at that for some instruction. Proverbs 1, verses 23 through 33 tell about God's people choosing to grieve the Holy Spirit. Listen to me as to what he says. Turn you at my reproof. Behold, I will pour out my spirit unto you. I will make known my words unto you. He's going to tell them what he wants them to do as he pours out the Holy Spirit. But listen to what he says. Because I have called and ye refused, I have stretched out my hand and no man regarded, but ye said it not, all my counsel, and would none of my reproof. You were convicted, but you wouldn't come. I also will laugh. You read it right. I will laugh at your calamity. I will mock when your fear cometh. When your fear cometh as desolation, and your destruction cometh as a whirlwind, when distress and anguish comes upon you. Then shall they call upon me, but I will not answer. They shall seek me early, but they shall not find me, as the pianists and musicians come. For they that hated knowledge, listen what he says, and did not choose the fear of the Lord, they would none of my counsel. They despised all my reproof. Therefore shall they eat the fruit of their own way and be filled with their own devices. For the turning away of the simple shall slay them, and the prosperity of fools shall destroy them. But whoso hearkeneth unto me shall dwell safely and shall be quiet from fear of evil. Whereby, grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you're sealed unto the day of redemption. I believe time's running out. I believe multitudes are going to be like the children of Israel. They're going to be lost in the wilderness. Unless they get in and get in quickly. Heavenly Father, help us as you speak. Do your office work this morning. We're done. Do what only you can do. In Jesus' name we pray. Shall we stand? Is he calling you? He's here this morning, and he's calling. Calling today. Jesus is calling through the call of the Holy Spirit. Is he speaking to you? As we sing, weary to rest, if you're coming, you need to start now. Sing one more verse. This is for you. Who's he waiting on, preacher? He's waiting on you. He's waiting on you. As I talked with the Lord this morning about you, he said, now, preacher, I'm going to speak to him. You can be assured that I'm going to touch hearts and minds. But now, little preacher boy, I don't want you to get discouraged. They may not listen to you, but don't feel too bad because they've not been listening to me. Grieve not the Holy Spirit, whereby ye are sealed. To the day of redemption. Heavenly Father, as you answer prayer for the one that's come. And as you dismiss us from this place, we don't want to go sinning against you. We don't want to leave grieving or quenching the Holy Spirit of God. And if there would be one that would choose to do that, would you convict them, make them so miserable in their sins that they come to a place where they get alone with you and call upon your name? Dismiss us from this place. Don't let us go from your presence. In your name we pray. Amen. Shake hands with everyone. You're dismissed.